Welcome back to the report. Now, the events in Brussels this morning have continued to place a sharp focus on the district of Molenbeek, where the fugitive suspect for last November's Paris massacre, Salah Abdel Salam, was captured on Friday, and where it is believed that most of those who carried out the Paris attacks lived. Labelled by the media as a hotbed for radicalisation, the area is home to settlers from North Africa. Our Europe correspondent, Davide Salvi, has this report.
When the alleged mastermind of the Paris attack, Salah Abdel Salam, was captured 4 days ago, there was little surprise he was hiding in Molenbeek. For months, the media attention has focused on the little town on the outskirts of Brussels. Some have called it Europe crucible of terror. Others have said it is the home of a very deep and very dangerous undercurrent of radical Islamism. What's for sure is that Molenbeek is in many ways similar to the banlieue in Paris. It is densely populated and is a large population from North Africa, very high unemployment, and many citizens complained about inadequate government services. In other ways, Molenbeek is rather different. It has a strong middle class, vibrant commercial districts, and a gentrified artist community. But journalists that have flocked in the city in those 4 months described the area like a typical, somewhat rundown district. Although it is far from being Europe's largest no-go area, more than 30 of the Belgian IS group fighters have come from the Molenbeek district. Two of the perpetrators of the last November's attacks in Paris have lived there. Underlying social tensions have long been present in Belgium, but it's one of those things that many assume but seldom discuss. Recent studies have shown that Belgian and French nationals make up around a quarter of the Europeans who went to fight in Iraq in the mid-2000s. While the Belgian government claimed that around 100 citizens have joined the fight for the group Islamic State, others pointed out that the number could be higher. An independent research calculated that Belgian fighters could be up to 516. Based on those numbers, Belgium has contributed more fighters per capita than any other European country. Anger and rage against the establishment may have radicalized the youth. Poverty has made the rest. Like Paris, the attacks in Brussels are a perfect excuse for anti-immigrant populists to gain votes. Some experts say until poverty and marginalization are addressed, people may be persuaded by the Islamic State group propaganda and continue to use violence against innocent people. Davide Salvi, The Report.
Well, to discuss this, I have political commentator on Muslim affairs, Mo Ansar. Welcome to the program, Mo. Is it the case that social deprivation and unemployment is one of the main causes of radicalization?
I think it's one of the key factors. I think you need to look at every individual case on its own merits. You need to look at what's been going on. And I think it's very, very important to keep these things contextualized. In terms of general themes, we know that the key themes relating to radicalization are things like social deprivation, disenfranchisement. There is obviously the theological question around having a false interpretation or a twisted ideology or a toxic understanding of what Islam is. Then we've got the foreign policy issue. We've got domestic policy. I think the interesting thing when you look at Molenbeek and you look at what's happening in Brussels is that going back almost 10 years, something like 84%, I think, of discrimination cases which were being brought to the Belgian courts were relating to Islam, and only 2% were relating to things like Christianity and Judaism. When you then factor in over the last two or three decades, the fact that that area and that region, that municipality, had become an industrial wasteland, and there was so much social deprivation, then in addition, you have to then factor in the idea that within this industrial or this post-industrial wasteland, Belgium underwent, and I think this is a really important case study for the rest of Europe and particularly Britain, which is going through a similar process. As the state shrunk and they had more devolution to the different regions, public institutions crumbled. And so for the first time, Belgium was in its ability to support low socioeconomic groups, socially disenfranchised group, marginalised group, was absolutely weakened. So this was a recipe for disaster.
But I've read that something like 30,000 people who are under the age of 30 live in Molenbeek, and about 20 have gone to Syria. So it's hard to call this area a sort of hotbed of radicalism or a sort of jihadi launch pad place.
Yeah, no, I completely agree. I think we have a similar sort of thing across Europe, actually, where the European Muslim social and demographic profile is far different to, if you like, the indigenous European populations, which is also causing consternation within white European communities. The average age across Europe is something like in its mid or late 40s, with less than one child per family. Muslim, the European Muslim profile is somewhere in the region of over four children. I think it's four and a half children per family, and an average age of 26. So you have a young, a very sophisticated, socially aware class of people. Now, of course, they're suffering policies of marginalization and discrimination. And the important thing to establish is that even within the UK, we had Department of Communities and Local Government study, I think it was called Study 220, which said that Muslims were suffering the brunt of discrimination and were the most discriminated against class within the UK. This was on all areas of social services, from housing, health, education, and so on. And that was issued some 6 months before the terrorism attacks of 9/11. So within Europe, we already have this backdrop of socioeconomic deprivation and marginalization. You then have to factor in this failed war on terror, Iraq, what's been happening out in Syria. We can't deny the idea that there are angry young European Muslims, but the overwhelming majority of Muslims reflect a peaceful Islam, are well integrated into their societies, are well contributing, and we see the heinous acts today, and we see them sadly on an increasingly regular basis. And of course we condemn them, of course we hate them, but we need to call that communities stay united at this time. I think the temptation is going to be, as we've seen from the hawks and the hard right, from Trump in the US to commentators and government officials all across Europe, they are talking about increasing this post-Schengen arrangement of high walls, high fences, increasingly hard approaches towards Muslim communities. This is only going to further inflame tensions. We need to be talking about peace building. We need to be talking about engaging with Muslim communities, how we improve the dialogue, how we get funding into these desperately needy communities who are suffering the most vulnerable of circumstances. And I think those are the big questions we're going to need to address in the future, not increasing and the hardening of the state apparatus towards Muslims.
And of course, the hashtag Stop Islam has been trending very strongly on Twitter. So there's a massive amount of prejudice around.
Yeah, it's been awful. My nemesis, Katie Hopkins, has been spearheading some of this hate. And it was fantastic to see Belgium's actually speaking out against her and telling her she's not welcome and refugees are welcome. I attended the anti-racism rally in London this weekend, which was there to stand against anti-Semitism, increasing Islamophobia, racism and discrimination of all kinds. And this we are seeing the hardening of these kind of views in Europe at the minute. The answer to increasing numbers of Muslims in Europe, migrant populations coming here, when we already have such a poorly equipped infrastructure, is to look at how we have a mass as economic growth as well as a rebuilding program within Europe. We have enough homes, we have enough land, we have enough jobs. We are the most prosperous region on the planet with some 740 million inhabitants and plenty of space. If we think about how to successfully integrate Muslim communities, then I think we have a potential recipe for success for the future. The problem we have is that these debates are being driven by hate, by prejudice, by hysteria, by anti-immigrant and largely anti-Muslim animus across Europe. And I think it's really going to be vital that those on the centre and on the left and those who are sympathetic to these causes on the right also start to talk positively and proactively about how do we get young Muslims to work? How do we stop the mass discrimination of Muslims in Europe? How do we get good theology and how do we develop dynamic and compelling Muslim leadership across Europe.
Well, let me just interrupt you there, but you mentioned good theology. I mean, what role have mosques played in the radicalization of these younger people? I mean, are they radicalized on the internet by, through friends, or are there still cases where there are very hardline Salafi type preachers who are teaching people to hate in the mosques?
Yeah, I think that's a really big question. Noam Chomsky said recently in an interview that if he was in the mainstream, he'd consider himself to be doing something wrong. I think radicalization, the government has been taking the wrong kind of advice from the wrong kind of people who have been over and over again discredited, like the likes of the Quilliam Foundation, who peddled this flawed model of a conveyor belt to radicalization. Others like the Institute of Counter-Radicalization Studies are also mirroring and mimicking and parroting that kind of view. The reality is this, that there is little or no evidence to show that radicalization happens within mosques. Mosques are areas where people go to pray, they go to congregate, but there certainly isn't political speak going on in mosques. When we have an increasingly divisive foreign policy, where we have domestic policies which are failing Muslim communities, it actually doesn't take a lot to get people extreme. It's not just Muslims who are going to the extremes. We've seen the rise of the far right. The idea that people are getting radicalized online, we're almost getting into a situation now where the government in the UK recently looked at Jeremy Corbyn and leading members of the Labour Party as being extremists and a national and a threat to a national interest, a national security threat. So it's almost getting into a situation where we've got the thought police saying anybody who thinks divergently, anybody who thinks against government interests or against corporate interests are somehow now on the extremes and in the margins of society. So the question isn't really one about what mosques are doing, because I think mosques have been leading the charge. Imams, Muslim institutions and organizations have been leading the charge and leading the debate on how we engage Muslim communities. I think what we're seeing here, this is being used as a tool to force a false, as I say, a faux reformation within Islam, where we've got revisionist academics like Tom Holland, we've got institutions and organizations at the heart of Whitehall, like the Henry Jackson Society, peddling this idea that the answer to increasing radicalization and terrorism overseas is a false reform of Islam, where people have to throw off their hijabs, they need to shave off their beards, they are able to disconnect their Islamic virtues and their behaviors in their beliefs from the core theology of Islam. Well, that isn't the answer. The answer is more Islam, and better and more nuanced teaching of Islam. The answer certainly is not to create a false reformation in Islam, which is being completely rejected by Muslim communities across Europe.
Okay, Mo and Sir, thank you very much. We'll have to end it there. Thanks for your contribution. I'm afraid now that is it for the whole of this episode of The Report. I want to thank my guests on the programme today. Thank you at home for taking the time to watch. You can keep up with us on Twitter by following @IslamChannelCA and by using the hashtag TheReport. We leave you now with some scenes from India, where people are demonstrating in protest at smoke billowing from a rubbish dump close to their homes. Good night.
पंपिंग सिस्टम ने कुछ नहीं बोरिंग नहीं किया है।